It is so nice to see you for what I think is going to be a really fun evening. We have tonight our guide for the perplexed, a little bit of information about this election cycle in New York City. So much to know, and I'm excited to jump into it. Just to say briefly before we get started, Lab Shul, as many of you know, is a nonpartisan organization. And so we aren't here tonight to talk about candidates and get into the nitty-gritty about that. What we're really here to do is to talk about the actual mechanics of the election, which I don't know about you, but I find really confusing. There's a lot going on and a lot of changes this year and a lot to understand. So I'm excited and hopeful that our guests tonight will help us to understand a little bit better what in the heck is happening in New York City right now, and help us to make some informed choices at the ballot next month. So to that end, tonight we'll be discussing three different topics. The first one is sort of broadly, how is this election year different? What is happening right now that's different from any other year? The second is, what is your ballot going to look like? We're going to talk a little bit more about ranked choice voting and learn a little bit about the different thoughts that are going into that. And then the third is, what are some tips for making informed choices? You know, like I said, I find all of this a little bit confusing. I also feel like there's a lot of information out there from so many different sources, and it is helpful to get some input, I hope, about kind of how to sift through everything that we're hearing about and feel really confident on election day. So without further ado, I want to introduce our moderator for this evening and our panelists. So our moderator for the evening is Holly Pretsky. She is a Lab Shul partner and the deputy managing editor at City and State New York. She's originally from Colorado and has reported from Colorado Springs and Miami and Washington, D.C. and Martha's Vineyard, and now is here in New York City with us in Brooklyn. Our two panelists tonight are Olivia Lapeyrolerie and Jeff Colton. Olivia is a seasoned media strategist with experience in government relations, campaigns, and crisis communications. Prior to joining SKDK as a vice president, Olivia served as Mayor de Blasio's first deputy press secretary, where she developed and implemented communication strategies for major policy and personnel announcements. Olivia received her master's degree in modern history from the University of St. Andrews in Scotland, and she is a published author and poet based in Brooklyn. Thank you so much for being here, Olivia. And Jeff is a senior reporter at City and State New York. In that role, he writes stories and develops other content for the magazine with a particular focus on New York City. He also writes the popular campaign confidential newsletter, which is focused on the 2021 elections. Jeff previously worked at New York One and at Bronx-based public radio station WFUV. And Jeff graduated in 2015 from Fordham University, where he studied political science, theology, and Italian food. Sounds delicious. Born and raised in Phoenix, Jeff now lives on Manhattan's Upper West Side. And thank you for being here, Jeff. I am going to turn things over to Holly, our moderator, who will get us going for this evening. Thanks for being here, Holly, Olivia, and Jeff.
Thanks so much for having us. Thanks to Lab Shul and to Sam and Sylvie for helping facilitate this. We really appreciate it. I think that, you know, my full-time job is to be following this, and I still find a lot of it really confusing, especially this year. There's a lot of changes happening. And so, yeah, we wanted to create a space where where we can like ask those really basic questions that sometimes people might forget to talk about because we get kind of caught up in the nitty-gritty of day-to-day campaign drama. Just a note, I'm kind of flipping back and forth. I'm having some internet issues, so I'm flipping back and forth between two screens here. So pardon my lack of eye contact a little bit. But just to get a sense of who's in the room tonight, I want to ask if you could just put a number in the chat between 1 and 10, 1 being you're like, what election? Oh, maybe I kind of heard about something's coming up. Like, what is that? 10 being like you're canvassing, you're door knocking, you've been following this for a while. Nice. Okay, so it seems like, yeah, we have some relatively engaged folks here with 7. The person who said 7 is going to be joining our panel. Okay, great. So, and one other thing, tomorrow, I just want to remember to say this, tomorrow is the last day that you can register to vote. So we can drop the link to register in the chat also, if anyone still needs to register to vote. And the primary is on June 22nd with early voting from June 12th to June 20th. Okay, so let's dive into our first topic, which is how is this election year different from previous elections?
Hey, I'm happy to start. A, thank you guys so much for having me. Really excited to be here. So in addition to the pandemic and the news cycle being insane and the Knicks being in the playoffs, what is, makes this election year so different in the city is that we're gonna be using ranked choice voting for the first time ever in our primary election. And it's for nearly all people you're gonna vote for on your ballot, but not everybody. It just depends on if they are technically, it's a city office or an office of the state. So like, if anyone who lives in Manhattan, your DA is not, for example, going to be a ranked choice vote.
Another big thing about this year is just that there are so many high profile elections. Bill de Blasio is term limited. Scott Stringer, the comptroller, is term limited. Basically every borough president is term limited. And also most city council seats, I think 36, 37, 40, I don't know, a lot of them, are term limited in. They're going to be new members. So if you remember the 2017 elections, which you might not because it was pretty boring, basically everybody was just reelected, the 2021 elections are huge. Everyone's been saying this is the most consequential city elections in a generation. And I totally agree with that. We're really seeing a lot of turnover.
So it seems like weird planning on someone's part to have everyone's term. And at the same time, like it seems like for stability, you would want there to be like a rolling kind of turnover. So, and we have, I think 35 out of the 51 council members are turning over. And like Jeff said, the mayor, the comptroller, borough president. So
it's Bloomberg's fault. It's Bloomberg's fault that he put in term limits again. There was all this back and forth, you know, in the late 2000s where term limits were enacted and then rescinded and then enacted again. And I think that's kind of what threw us onto this current system where we have a lot of turnover this year and very little turnover 4 years ago.
I will add though, like, yes, the point about stability is important. And like, luckily there are so many people who work in government and are not in elected offices that kind of help between changes of administration, but it's also a little bit exciting. So I feel like we have had kind of like the same guard in office for a long time and feel how you want about them. That's a whole other topic that we could spend a whole other Zoom call on, but it is kind of exciting that there will be so many fresh faces and fresh ideas and fresh perspectives to solve some of our thorniest problems, because lucky for the people that actually end up getting elected, they will be responsible really for the city's recovery. So big problems, but hopefully having some fresh blood in the mix.
That's the right attitude.
Only be good for the city. I'm being optimistic.
And hopefully turnout will be reflected too. Like I'm hoping that because this is such a big high consequential election. I'm hoping more people than ever will come out to vote.
And isn't it new also that the election is in June, or the primary is in June? So what's the deal with that?
Yeah, I forgot about that, yeah. Also, previously, all the primaries, the city primaries have been in September. So candidates have been, you know, really campaigning hard throughout the summer, and then like Labor Day weekend was huge. This year it's different. Now they've been campaigning through the spring, and Memorial Day weekend is huge. So yes, the primary is going to be in June for the first time. A lot of like the state primaries last year were in June. Congressional primaries have been in June. So it's not totally new, but that just has to do with state law changing. So yes, it's earlier. We're going to have a, you know, Democratic mayor, mayoral candidate, likely winner earlier than ever.
Because of ranked choice voting, are we going to have like an election night party where we all gather and see and watch the returns and see who won all of these elections?
I think it'll take a little bit longer for them to count based on what's happening. And kind of, I know, for example, the first, so we've already had one ranked choice election in the city. There was, I think, two special elections up in the Bronx. That is like a little bit hard to compare to what we're going to have in June, because those were all, and correct me if I'm wrong, Jeff, there, I believe they're all counted by hand, which was a super arduous process and took a long time. But luckily, our Board of Elections, which I'll refer to as the BOE, because when you work in government, everything is an acronym, the BOE has finally approved for the June primary to use actual like a system to count it, so it won't be counted by hand. But I don't think we will know who our primary winners are on the 22nd.
Yeah, in fact, the BOE said that they're not going to officially count the ranked choice votes for 3 weeks. So we're not going to get the final results until mid-July, probably something like July 12th, 13th, 14th. That said, we are going to get preliminary results on election night. And, you know, some races, candidates are going to be so far ahead, you know, clear winner on election night, that it's basically going to be decided. You know, there won't be an official winner for 3 weeks, but we'll have a really good sense of it. That's much more true for races like, you know, maybe some city council races or the public advocate race, where Jumaane Williams is just going to cruise to victory, where we're going to be really confident who wins there. But we're probably going to be in a state of flux and, you know, questioning who's going to be the next mayor for like 3 weeks after election day. But will there be parties? Yes. I have asked a few candidates. They are hesitant about planning big parties because, you know, we're still a little touchy about COVID. But I think there's going to be some big outdoor events for some mayoral candidates and other candidates. If anybody's looking to really get involved on election night and, you know, watch New York One on a big screen somewhere.
We got a question in the chat from Neil about specific candidates. Generally, this discussion is more about like preparing for ranked choice voting and the kind of offices that are up for election. But I wonder if Jeff and Olivia, if you want to do just a really quick, like rapid fire run down the top eight mayoral candidates and describe kind of like where they stand, maybe on the ideological spectrum. Some of them are hard to kind of place, but that it might just be helpful to just do a quick like roll call on those. Mm-hmm.
You want to start this one out? Or?
I was like, you start, because I'm trying to think of ways to not add my own ideology.
Sure. I can give the broad sense. So well, actually, first and foremost, I want to say that the website The City, which I think is thecity.nyc, and Gothamist have both been doing, they've been doing a very good job of easy comparisons of the leading mayoral candidates. You can go on their sites, they have different issues, you know, graphics that you can compare the candidates on. So if you're, you know, undecided and really looking, oh, where did they fall, would recommend The City and Gothamist. But broadly, we'll give you the rundown here. There's eight leading mayoral candidates. You know, there's so many ways to divide them. I guess I'll start with the progressive pack. The ones that are the most progressive on the left would be Diane Morales. She's a former nonprofit executive. Her campaign is currently going through some real drama. They're unionizing, they're furious at her. It's been blowing my mind the past couple of days. There's some coverage online if you want to learn more about Diane Morales. But there's also Maya Wiley. She was the former counsel to de Blasio. She was also a legal analyst on MSNBC. There's Scott Stringer, the New York City comptroller. He was last month accused of sexual harassment from 20 years ago. And his campaign has been definitely hurt from that, but he's still running strong. He denies it and is definitely one of the more progressive candidates. Olivia, take over, please.
I would say then probably in the middle center column, I would put Ray McGuire, who is a former executive of Citibank, and it's his first foray into politics. Then you have Sean Donovan, who has worked mainly at the federal level, but also in the city doing kind of, I would call him the housing guy. He used to be the head of the housing preservation department in the city. He was also the head of HUD at the federal level, as well as OMB under President Obama. Then I guess I would put Eric Adams in the center column too. He is the former, or he's the current Brooklyn Borough President. I also believe he served in state office in Brooklyn and used to be a police officer with the NYPD for many years. So he's a really well-known figure in Brooklyn and as well as in police reform spaces. Who else am I forgetting?
Catherine Garcia, I think we haven't.
Oh, yeah, Catherine.
And Andrew Yang.
Also, yeah, I guess it is really the centrist versus the progressive. So yeah, Catherine Garcia was the former city sanitation commissioner. She has gotten, I would say, a lot of support amongst folks who, A, the sanitation union, which is a really powerful union in the city, as well as what I kind of call like the climate change advocacy crew. I think the League of Conservation Voters just endorsed her. Then Andrew Yang, who is new to city politics, but ran for president before, and has had probably like, I would say of everyone, probably the most name recognition in this cycle, despite being a newer figure to city politics.
Right, and I will say that I know I started out with like the most progressive and then, but admittedly, a lot of these candidates are really hard to characterize. You know, Andrew Yang is all over the map. Some of his positions are traditionally conservative. Some of them are traditionally progressive. Some are just, you know, out there. So, you know, the mayoral politics doesn't fall on the spectrum as cleanly as like national federal politics we see with congressional races. There's just some really idiosyncratic issues here. And that's kind of what makes following it interesting and fun.
Yes, and the Democratic politics in the city is very messy. And I think sometimes people, how they present themselves on their campaign websites might not fit into any definitions that we would necessarily say, whether that's progressive or centrist or et cetera. So I would say also, Neil, like check out their websites, but also know that God bless politicians, they aren't super self-critical of themselves. So like read City and State and check out other local news outlets. They actually have kind of more on the nose coverage of what's happening than say if you just like look at their candidates' respective websites.
And so all eight of those candidates are running in the Democratic primary. So I guess we should talk about why the primary feels so important and also what's going on with the Republican candidates.
I'll say I just looked up the numbers this morning so I can report, I have them memorized now. There are 3.5 million Democrats registered in New York City, and there are only 500,000 Republicans. So that is a 7-to-1 ratio of Democrats to Republicans. There's also 1 million independents, which, you know, split both ways. But long story short, the Democratic primary is what matters, because with a 7-to-1 advantage, there is a very, 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 very small chance that a Republican will ever win citywide election again. Or at least no time recently.
And then on the Republican side, I can talk about this because I watched the debate last night on New York One, which if you want, it was very colorful. Recommend anyone watch if they want to check it out. There are two people running, Fernando Mateo, who I believe is from Washington Heights and is a small business owner, and then Curtis Lewa, who is obviously a really well-known figure in the city, head of the Guardian Angels. I don't know where he lives, but he always has a red beret on. So
he lives on the Upper West Side. He moved here recently after decades and decades in Canarsie.
Yeah, so those are two people running for the Republican primary.
So Jeff, you mentioned like what a long shot it is for a Republican to win, but didn't one win relatively recently? Like, didn't we have a Republican mayor pretty recently?
So we're right. I mean, Michael Bloomberg won as a Republican in 2001 and 2005, and then he ran as an independent technically in 2009, but, you know, he was still the same person. So yes, admittedly, it has happened relatively recently, but I guess with my political pundit hat on, I think the Republican brand has gotten so much worse in New York City, thanks to Trump. And even before that, really, it's just toxic. I think before, Democrats might have been more willing to vote across the party line for a candidate they liked, like Bloomberg. And also just the candidates we have for mayor this year, I don't think Mateo or Sliwa are working very hard to like reach across the aisle and appeal to a lot of Democrats. So they're there, they're gonna, you know, get their voices heard in the general, but I think that the Democratic primary is really the race. True for mayor, true for comptroller, true for almost every city council race in the city as well.
And why are there so many people, like, why are there so many kind of prominent people running for mayor? Like, to have eight people who seem kind of like they're all, you know, they're all included in the debates, is that normal?
Hey, I will start. It is really the first time in 8 years that City Hall is up for grabs, because historically, if there's a strong incumbent, which I put many asterisks on, because obviously the party is constantly changing, people won't run against that incumbent. So it's kind of been like people have been, I think, in the wings waiting for this for many years. And it's the first time City Hall is really up for grabs in 8 years. So that's why I think we have so many people out there. I also think too that like with ranked choice voting and it kind of being hard to predict what will happen exactly, I think a lot of folks were kind of like, hey, like this is different. I'm gonna throw my hat in the ring, because A, it's up for grabs, and B, it's not gonna be like a normal election where folks coalesce around certain people. But then I say that, and then also in 2013, there were so many people, I think eight at the time in the primary, a little bit less, but.
Yeah, I think there were like four or five pretty serious candidates. So it wasn't much smaller.
Okay.
Yeah, but I will say that RCV is actually, I think, ranked choice voting is keeping, it's discouraging candidates from dropping out, because in the previous style of election, there's always the concern that, you know, two similar candidates would like split the vote and let another win. But with RCV, in theory, that won't be a problem, because, you know, ideological candidates can kind of get votes together and win. We'll see how that works in practice, but it does mean that candidates are discouraged from dropping out before the election.
And we will get into a little bit more of an explainer on ranked choice voting and how that works in a second, but we got a question in the chat about whether independents can vote in the primaries.
Nah, we have a closed primary system in New York, so you have to be a registered Democrat. And I'm pretty sure that the deadline to change your registration has already passed. Not positive, but pretty sure.
And does that mean that people strategically register as Democrats even if they don't align necessarily with the party?
Yes, and in fact, there have been at least two or three PACs, political action committees this year, that have actually explicitly encouraged Republicans and independents to register as Democrats, saying, look, even if you don't, you know, align with the Democratic Party, strategically, you should be a registered Democrat in New York City so your voice is heard in these primaries. I found that to be very interesting. It does mean that, you know, maybe the Democratic electorate in New York is going to be a little more diluted or a little bit less ideologically coherent than in some other cities, but that's the system we have.
Great. Let's move on to our next topic, which is just a little bit closer look at ranked choice voting. And the city made a good video, I thought, to explain how it works. So we're going to share the screen and show that video. It's about a minute long.
Hey, NYC voters. There's a new way to vote for your city officials in 2021. The City of New York will use the ranked choice voting method for all NYC primaries and special elections for mayor, public advocate, comptroller, borough president, and city council. Ranked choice voting gives New York voters more choice than ever before. Rather than choosing just one candidate, now you have the option to rank up to five of your favorite candidates. Here's how it works. Mark your ballot by order of preference, ranking as many or as few candidates as you like. In the first column, fill in the oval next to your first choice candidate, your second choice in the second column, followed by your third, fourth, and fifth choice. At the close of Election Day, all first choice votes are counted. The candidate to receive over 50% of votes wins. If no candidate receives over 50% of the first choice votes, the race moves to round two. The person with the least number of votes is eliminated. If your first choice candidate does not win and they're eliminated, we then count your second choice vote and add it to the candidate's total. This process continues until we have a winner. Go to vote.nyc to learn more about NYC ranked choice voting and upcoming elections.
Thank you, Sylvie. So one question, why are we doing ranked choice voting? Like, where did this idea come from?
Because the good people of New York said they wanted to do ranked choice voting. So a little bit of background, the main governing document in New York City is the city charter. And in 2018, the mayor and the council said, hey, like, we want to take a fresh look at the charter and see if there's any way we can update or modernize the laws. And from that commission, they recommended that we try ranked choice voting, that we voted on that in 2018, I think. And I think nearly 75% of voters said, yes, let's do ranked choice voting.
The idea also came from our good friends over in San Francisco and Oakland. New York is the biggest city to enact ranked choice voting. And the biggest state, because the state of Maine does ranked choice voting. And yeah, the cities of San Francisco and Oakland. I think there's some others around the country, some smaller ones. But yeah, we're in an interesting position because New York is the biggest and most high profile place to do ranked choice voting in the country yet. But we're not the first, you know, that we've had, San Francisco's been doing it for like 10 years or maybe more, and we've let them kind of work out the kinks. And hopefully New York will get it right in this first time.
So what is the goal, or why is ranked choice voting, like, what is it trying to accomplish? Just, it seems like a lot, it makes it really complicated. There must be some advantage to that.
So people who like it say that it encourages less mean campaigning, and it also makes so that candidates are speaking to a broader cross-section of the electorate, as opposed to just, like, let's say a historic base or people they're just trying to make sure that to vote for them, because since it's not like I'm going to just vote for Jeff, I have the option to vote for Jeff and everyone on this screen too. So I think the thinking there is that it's like, hey, like, I have to be a little bit nicer to my fellow candidates, as well as work a little bit harder to talk to some more voters. I've also read too, and I haven't seen any like data on this, but I'm curious to see kind of what happens in our race, that it can help marginalized people, women, people of color who have a harder time traditionally fundraise, actually do better in elections, because they, even if they're not getting ranked first, they might get ranked someone second or third, and depending on what happens, that could propel them to the top.
Yeah, I'm very interested in that aspect of it, because the supporters of ranked choice voting say that it's great for Black and Brown communities and marginalized districts of the city. And then the opponents of ranked choice voting say that this is really bad for Black and Brown voters, and that, you know, this is going to make the elite progressives win every race. From what I've heard, the former is more true, that it really is a good democratic tool to help candidates from all communities. But, you know, I guess we'll see how it does play out in New York and whether that's true.
It seems like a lot of the concerns arise from, like, okay, if you're going to adopt this, you really have to then follow through and make sure people get it and know how to do it, right?
Absolutely. And I think knock on the city, because while that video was great, I feel like we're just getting these things from them now, whereas we really should have probably started doing this kind of outreach to the public last year at the very latest, really. So I think that in terms of public education, the city and the Board of Election have not done all that they can do to make sure people understand it, because it is really confusing.
Yeah, it's a good point too. It's not just the system itself that has been raising concerns. It's the fact that wealthier, higher educated voters will receive the information and like know how to use it, basically, whereas like lower information voters won't be able to. So that has been a concern that's been raised, and you know, a lot of politicians have been working hard to spread the word to their districts around the city and make sure that it's not just the New York Times reading elites that know how to use ranked choice voting. And look, we've got a month left. I know that all the polling has shown that knowledge and understanding of RCV has been really improving over the past couple months. So that is good to see. And I hope that it's adopted widely or used widely.
And do you have to rank? Like if someone walks into the polls, they've never heard of ranked choice voting, they missed all the memos about it. Like, are they just gonna have to rank anyway?
No, yeah, you can put one if you want. There is no, there's no penalty to just voting for one candidate. I guess the strategy might be different, but your vote counts just as much as anybody else's. If you decline to use ranked choice voting.
And is it possible for a person to win the election even if they didn't get the most first place votes?
I think yes, depending on what happens when you go into what I call the elimination rounds and how many like are you in like people's second choices and third. So I think yes.
Yeah, it's rare. Most of the time, the candidate with the most number one votes will end up winning the election. I think it's like 96% of the time possibly, but there's still that 4% where the candidate that doesn't get the most first place votes picks up a lot of the second places, third places, fourth places, fifth places, and that kind of leapfrogs them ahead of the initial, you know, the most number one votes candidate. So look, that does kind of freak some people out. They're like, no, you know, that's not our system. Like that's different. But it in theory, that candidate has a broader base of support. They have more voters that are willing to rank them and put them on their ballot. So that's why they win. It's an interesting system.
And have either of you observing, I guess, particularly the mayor's race or the controller's race or any of the other races, have you noticed there's a shift in tone that people are being more cordial or forming alliances, supporting one another?
It does feel a little less gloves off than years before, but we are still in New York and it is still politics. So it's not entirely everyone being best friends. And I'm curious to see what happens over the next couple of weeks as the poll, as it kind of like coalesces around who is getting higher in the polls. And if folks in an attempt to change what they think might happen, kind of change their tone a little.
A couple months ago, Andrew Yang was really talking up Catherine Garcia, fellow mayoral candidate, saying like, Garcia is going to be my number two. I think she's great. I think she's going to, you know, she would be so good. Like I want to hire her when I become mayor. And then recently, Catherine Garcia has really been rising in all the polls and seems to be doing better. And just this week, Yang kind of like turned on her and was like, ah, you know, she like, she's responsible for all the trash on the street and like, she's tied to de Blasio. So that was kind of funny to see. It was like, at the beginning, ranked choice voting was like this good tool for peaceful campaigning. But then once Yang started feeling threatened, he's like, no more peaceful campaigning. It's time to, you know, gloves are off.
And you mentioned polls. I wonder if there's, like, how do we know that people, that we can still poll for a ranked choice election? Like, is there skepticism now around polling? And I mean, I think polling in general is kind of not doing great since the 2016 election. People have had a lack of trust in polling, but how do you even begin to predict how ranked choice election will turn out for the first time even?
The pollsters are definitely up in a tizzy about it. And I'm not saying all of them, but a lot of them are like, we're not trying to make predictions on what's going to happen because it's hard for us to figure out what this will look like in a city as large and complex as New York. So as with all polls, I agree with you, Holly, take them with a grain of salt. Yeah, also some campaigns have been doing releasing their internal polls, which naturally their candidate does really well. So also if you see an internal poll, take that with even two doses of grain of salt.
The New York Times just wrote a good story saying that all the major, like the most prominent pollsters, like the Quinnipiac and Marist and Siena, all these like big names that have polled New York well in the past are just staying out this year. They're like, we don't know how to poll RCV. So we're just gonna stay out. So yes, there've been a lot of less trusted pollsters that have been polling the campaign. One thing I would actually recommend is Wikipedia, the Wikipedia page for the 2021 New York City Democratic primary has this really nice graphics. It has all the polls that you can like run through. It has like one of those charts that shows, you know, trends and who's going up and who's going down. And I think that's actually so much more helpful than just looking at any one individual poll and trying to get a sense of it. You can look at these trends on Wikipedia, shout out to Wikipedia, and get a sense of like, oh wow, like, you know, Yang is up top and then he like was fading a little bit and, you know, aggregation, it's good.
And generally we're still in a phase right now, right? Where the person who is winning in the polls is the unknown, like people who say, I don't know who I'm voting for, right? Or are we moving out of that phase where people are starting to have more name recognition and we're actually having a real candidate who's winning the polls?
There's still a lot of undecideds in every poll I've seen. I think undecided is still, you know, winning most of the polls I've seen. Olivia, have you seen anything? You know, I haven't noticed that trend of people deciding, honestly.
No, and I think because we're all just so fatigued from the events of the past 15 months and just kind of trying to wrap our heads around the news cycle, that I feel like people are just starting to really tune in right now and try to figure out who they want to rank on their ballots. So it does feel very much like a jump ball at this point.
And we had a question in the chat about early voting. Do either of you want to talk about how someone figures out how to participate in early voting?
Yeah, and I'm happy to, I did this back in November when we did early voting. Because I think that was one of the first times we did early voting in New York City for that long period of time. Don't quote me on that. But hey, so traditionally in New York, definitely check before you go because your normal polling place might not be your early voting place. There are fewer early voting places as opposed to main election day polling locations. So definitely check before you go. Also check the hours because it's kind of like each day is a little bit different. I really enjoyed early voting back in November, and Laura, I had the same concerns about you with COVID. There were less people, and I also, you know, I've spent a lot of my time working in the city saying not so nice things about the Board of Elections, but I do think they did a really great job handling voting during a pandemic, and it was really well spaced out, and I didn't feel like I was in an unsafe situation at all. And they had really good safety precautions in place in terms of like hand sanitizer and then making sure your physical where you filled out your ballot was 6 feet apart, and they weren't letting a lot of folks in at a time. So I felt really good about it. Definitely, it's like vote.nyc, I think is the website. Check the location because it will most likely not be the same place you cast the ballot on election day.
Yes, they have announced the locations already. I think they put it up on the website recently. So you can just put in your address. They'll tell you where you can early vote. You don't have to sign up in advance. You can just show up if you're registered and vote early. It starts June 10th, Saturday, June 10th, and it lasts through the week and a half until June 22nd, election day. And I see, Sam, you were asking about safety precautions. Honestly, I don't know, but I think so. I think so. I've been to Board of Election events, and I they're very careful about plexiglass barriers and lots of hand sanitizer, and everyone's wearing masks. I expect this will be a very still a very COVID safe election.
And when people show up to vote because of just how many things are turning over, they're gonna be faced with a ballot that has like dozens and dozens of people on it. So what do you guys do to prepare? Do you like print something out and bring it, or how do you, especially when you have to rank, because you don't just have to remember one candidate for each election, you have to remember five. So what's your strategy going in?
Also on vote.nyc, just like I'm spending so much time on this website these days, you can get a sample ballot. You just like have to put in your address and your house number, and you'll get exactly what the ballot will look like when you show up to the polls. So I found that really helpful for me, particularly with things like judges, which I know we want to talk about a little bit later, which are traditionally less advertised than other races. But I'm probably going to take notes on my phone and just have that in there, because I have a bad memory and we have to rank and there's a lot of options. But I think checking your ballot out before is a good way to see what's up, and from there figure out who you want to look up, so it can be an easy process when you actually get to your polling location.
I second that. It's totally fine to bring out your phone in the polling place. I know it kind of feels like, you know, official sometimes, but I've done it. You can break out the phone when you're in the booth and read your notes and remind yourself who to vote for, especially, yeah, when you're ranking down the ballot. So prepare, you know, prepare in advance. Make sure you know who you're ranking, and then you can just go in the booth and fill it out right there.
So speaking of preparing in advance, our next segment is about how to make these decisions, how to do this research. So I wanted to just start out by asking, people are going to be voting for their city council member. So what does the city council do? Why is that person important?
Hey, so similar to, I'll start like at a high level and then I'll talk about the city council. Similar to at the federal level, this New York City government is based on a series of checks and balances. And the city council is the main law-making body. So kind of their responsibilities are they write and pass things into law. They also are responsible for reviewing and adopting the city budget, which they work really closely with the mayor on, but again, it's very much a back and forth. They also oversee what land, or they regulate, I guess, land use. So any kind of rezoning, that's gonna be going through the city council as well too.
And constituent services, of course, you know, if you have a problem, if, I don't know, there's construction noise on your block, or you are having trouble with a landlord, you can call up your city council member. That's different city council members will focus more on constituent services versus focusing more on like the budget. And that's always interesting to find out where people are focused. But yeah, city council's definitely an important gig.
And what about borough president? If we have a mayor and we have city council members who represent us in our neighborhoods, like what does the borough president need to do?
Borough president's a little more ceremonial. They have fewer assigned jobs. They do have little bit of budget power to give out money to nonprofits and other, you know, local groups that can get money from the city budget. So there's a little bit there. They help appoint community boards. So they really have, you know, power over who is running that lowest level of government. But like, honestly, I mean, I am gonna partly decide borough president based on like, who's the best cheerleader for the borough. I think that's a really big part of the job, is like promoting your borough and like, you know, kind of working with all the elected officials and like doing some, you know, unity or crossover work, that kind of stuff. And also borough president is a good stepping stone to higher office. I think that's a big role that it's played. You know, like Brooklyn borough president Eric Adams is one of the leading mayoral candidates this year because he's been a borough president for 8 years.
I also think too, they have a lot of their powers being like the chief borough cheerleader, is that they normally have a direct line to the mayor and often the governor, kind of to discuss what are any issues in their neck of the woods too. So I think that is where a lot of their power comes to.
And what about public advocate?
So they are the city's, I like to think of them as like the city's chief watchdog. They're monitoring and investigating city agencies. I think that they can't vote in the city council, but they can introduce a bill, I think, in conjunction with the council member. But I think their biggest kind of responsibility is that if for whatever reason the mayor is unable to serve, that person will assume the mayor's duties. So they're second in line for the mayor's office. And I kind of think that it's like, it's been a great stepping stone for people to become the mayor, because Bill de Blasio used to be the public advocate. And I think whoever's in that office, since it is a relatively newer position in all of ours, they can kind of like set the tone with what they want to do with that office and with that bully pulpit.
And that race is not super competitive, right? This time around, Jumaane Williams is like, it seems like he's loved by all.
Yeah, he was just elected in a special election 2 years ago, and he doesn't have any serious competition. So he gets to just chill out and not worry too much about the big elections. And I do see that they're full-time. Yeah, all the jobs are full-time. And Olivia, remind me, I think that there's a new law that you can't even take outside income, basically. Like, you used to be able to be like a lawyer and a city council member, or a doctor and a city, but now you can't. Now you are just a city council member. You can, you know, maybe like teach one college class on the side, but pretty much fully focused. City council members make like $156,000 a year. Comptroller makes like $250,000. They're pretty good gigs, you know? I'd take them.
Jeff, are you running? Is this year declaring your candidacy?
Yeah, think about it. I just for the money. I don't care about doing good work.
What about district attorneys? Is that something that people in all five boroughs will be voting on, or just certain boroughs?
I think technically Bronx and Brooklyn are electing DAs this year, but the only actual competitive race where there's any chance of the incumbent not winning is Manhattan, because the district attorney for the past 12 years, Cy Vance, is retiring. He's stepping down, he's not running for re-election. And so we will have a new Manhattan district attorney, which is of course a very powerful position and a real competitive race. That one's very interesting to see.
But you're not going to rank choice vote for that one. You're just going to vote normally, because technically it is an office of the state and not a city office, which is why there's no ranked choice voting there.
Got it.
And I'm sure some of you saw the news that a grand jury has been convened to review a possible criminal case against Donald Trump. That is being handled by the Manhattan District Attorney's Office. And it's expected that it's going to last into next year with the new district attorney. So that's a real, shadow over the, or a theme in the Manhattan district attorney's race, is like, who is going to inherit this case, this incredibly high profile, incredibly important case against the former president.
And they can't really talk that much about it, right, when they're campaigning, because then if they were to win, everything they said would be used against them in the case. Or is it illegal for them to talk about it, or why can't they? What's the restriction there?
If they talk about it, then when Donald Trump is potentially on trial, he can be like, look, you know, this district attorney's totally biased against me, and like try and tell the judge to throw it out. So they're all trying to be strategic in, you know, like they all clearly really dislike Donald Trump and really want the opportunity to prosecute him. So it's been funny as they try and like imply that, while also all the candidates are like, of course I can't speak about this case. I must be respectful to the political process. So
now that we have a few more minutes left here, I just wanted to ask, where would you recommend that people go aside from Wikipedia? We talked about the city, Gothamist. The city has amazing, like, kind of choose your own adventure through different issues to figure out which candidates you align with. What other advice do you have? And also, what's the deal with judges? Like, how do you figure out who to vote for with judges in New York City?
I would say it's the shadiest process, how we elect judges, how you find out about judges. And basically, because if you look on your ballot, like, you will have the option to vote for, and those are also not ranked choice voting, just normally pick the judge that you want for, like, kind of the lower level courts, like the people who are deciding wills and estates and landlord and tenant cases and things of that nature. But then for, like, the Supreme Court, aka the stuff that we are, like, seeing on Law and Order, like the really big cases, you don't actually get to choose those judges. You choose a slate, I think they call themselves slate of delegates, who then select the judge that you get to vote on in the general election. That person is often run unopposed, and it's totally done in backroom deals by the local county parties. So it is very shady. I also think too that there is some state law really restricting how judges can campaign. I don't know why exactly. So it's like often there's very little about them, but so you're gonna have to do some kind of creative Googling to find, unless there's a good media resource, Jeff and Holly, of things out there, because I've always really struggled with what the judges' deals are.
I always look up, like, the New York City Bar Association will either give, they basically just give a thumbs up or a thumbs down to all the candidates, and so sometimes it's nice to, like, take notes down and be like, which one's got a thumbs down? Because if they got a thumbs down, there's, like, clearly a problem with them, because most of them get thumbs up. So it's good to, like, check that website, see who got the thumbs down, and then be sure not to vote for them. But otherwise, even us who are, like, so high information and, like, are in this world of politics, I have no idea who to vote for judge. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, our colleague Rebecca Lewis wrote an article recently about the how politics kind of permeate the judiciary in New York. And since reading that, I'm kind of like, I don't know if it's up to me, you know, like that seems to be an area where there needs to be reform more than like, it's up to me as an individual to like try and research these people. It seems like designed to be a little bit difficult to understand.
They do not want us figuring out what their deal is. That's 100% sure.
One last question before I turn it back over to Sam. What do you think has been the spiciest moment of this election season?
Honestly, it's happening now with this Diane Morales shakeup, I think.
Yeah, this is interesting to see. She was the progressive champion and progressive front runner, and now she's being accused of retaliating against staff when they're trying to form a union. It's been very dramatic, very interesting to see. But I mean, also what's been interesting is the staying power of Andrew Yang. You know, this guy was presidential candidate out of nowhere, and now he's like moving that fame of the presidential campaign to being, you know, the leading candidate for mayor. It's been crazy. He came out of nowhere, really.
I will also say too, and this is definitely political inside baseball, but this is my life. I thought that in the first mayoral debate, which was a couple of weeks ago on New York One, Sean Donovan and Ray McGuire, who both seem like very nice, mild-mannered men, have like secret beef. And I thought that was hysterical because I think probably on paper, they are in alignment on most views, but they just really do not get along. And I thought that was a funny little spicy moment.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Got to keep the interpersonal beef interesting, you know, otherwise politics would be so boring.
Well, thank you both so much. I hope this has been helpful and informative. I learned a lot from you both, and I appreciate the opportunity. I'm going to hand it back over to Sam.
Yeah, I want to thank all three of you, to Holly for really working closely with me and Rabbi Amichai, putting this night together, connecting us with Jeff, and Jeff to Olivia. So grateful to all three of you for such an informative evening. Feeling a little more confident about making some choices and getting my ballot ready for the election. Sylvie just dropped in the chat a link to register to vote. Like Holly mentioned at the beginning, the deadline to register is tomorrow. So I think you have until June 2nd to change your address, but if you need to register, the deadline is tomorrow. Sylvia is also putting a link in the chat to Jeff's election newsletter, which is called Campaign Confidential. I just signed up. I'm really excited, very appreciative. Also consider signing up. Olivia, also a fan, amazing. And then we're also putting in a link with just some more information from the city about ranked choice voting, if that is something that you're looking for. So again, thank you so much, Olivia, Jeff, Holly. It's been a really great evening. And I'm so appreciative for all three of you for helping us out. So I hope everybody has a great night. We'll see you soon.
Thank you.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.